The question then comes, either you as a being prospective customs broker examinee or customs broker, you are being asked to clear this water. But by the way, this water is being imported. It comes, I believe, from Norway, product of Norway, artesian water, product of Norway. So this water comes from Norway in glass bottles. Do I clear this as water? And I just kind of assume that this type of packaging is kind of normal. Or because this article is so durable, it's clearly suitable for repetitive. It's clearly suitable for repetitive use. I know it's because I use it repetitively. Should I classify this as water plus glass container? What do you guys think? No. Well, yes. So, yes. I would most likely classify it as just water. Yes, it is suitable for clearly for repetitive use, but here is the thing. The provision is not binding. Not binding, what does it mean, not binding? Not binding means that it's discretionary. If customs official, the import specialist, all known import specialist on the customs broker exam, sits and decides, well, I'm not going to use this clause as a binding, and I'm going to say that GRI 5B does not apply to this transaction. To you, as the exam taker, it means for you the red light. Now I cannot classify it as water only. I need to break it out. But if you do not have that, it's not binding. Meaning it's discretionary. So you can use this. This is one of those gray areas, right? Where there is no specific rule on point. Of course, you have to check, there may be some binding precedent, but just by reading here, there is no rule on point. And what does it mean for us as licensed customs brokers when we serve our customers? Well, we check. What's the duty for the glass container? What's the duty for water? Artesian water, let's say. And if the cost of container, the duty for container is less than the duty for water, then you can use that not binding clause to break them out, and this way you can lower the duty, right? Because if this comprises a major cost of the product, you can save on duty by breaking it out separately. And you'll be within the boundaries, unless there is, again, we're limited to universe of this. Of course, there is other points we need to check. I would check if there is a binding precedent, such as a binding rulings. I would see if there are any court cases on this one. I would do the preliminary homework to see if I can use this gray area to interpret this rule favorable to the client. Right? So this is part of being a good customs broker, is you need to see those gray areas and you need to use them favorably. And hopefully the client will appreciate this. But that's 5B. That's 5B. Okay, so let's see. What are the factors? Here is a list of factors which I think are important in considering special shape of fitness, right? The article must be designed to fit its whatever its use it is designed to be used for. Durability of protection. If it's more durable, then it may be you may have to break it out. Simply because you simply do not put something in a very expensive, nice vase, which is you're going to just throw away, like or just simply eat and or dispose of, like such as this sugar example that we talked about. Present it with the articles, it's a must. If you present packaging separately, the container must actually contain the article. So if you have the gun case, which is shipped in a separate box, and the gun, which is shipped in another separate box, then the GRI 5 does not apply, because the case is a case. It is designed to as a container. So if you're going to classify it as a container with the article, you better show that you intend to use it as such container. Of a kind of normally sold, well, again, you look at the practicals in the commerce. So using this glass bottle as an example, if the water, let's say it's a higher end expensive water, if it is normal for the upper higher end water to be sold in glass containers just to make it stand out from the marketing perspective, then there is nothing wrong with classifying water with the glass container with water, not as a separate line item. Essential character. Remember that candy example again. The container must not take over that article. It must not give the whole product essential character. It simply must be used as a packaging, as a protection shell, to protect the product from damaging, to make it convenient to carry the item around. Repetitive use. Yes, it's not binding, but it's a factor. Repetitive use is a factor. Jewelry boxes and cases. Electric shaver cases. Binocular cases. Musical instrument cases and gun cases are example where packaging, even though they can be expensive, they are not classified separately. They are classified as a part of the item. Sometimes those things can be quite expensive too. So keep this in mind. Any questions?
I have a question.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking of if the package have individual function. For example, I remember that my kitchen have the salt, and they have the grinder with the bottle. Is it considered a packaging or not really a packaging? It is an individual function of that of that bottle as a grinder.
So whether you classify grinder, so you have a grinder.
Yeah. When I bought the sea salt, it come with the bottle, and on the top of the bottle, they have a grinder.
Because this is a situation where you really have a situation of utilitarian use. So here's what one customs opinion. Again, I do not have the answer on top of my head.
Okay.
But look, so we have a disposable glass bottle with a grinder cap that has what? Pepper in it, right? Grinder cap is removable, so you can twist it off. And cap is entirely made of plastic. So you have a glass bottom with a pepper or salt and plastic cap, which you, I guess, you turn and
in the case.
All right. So let's see what Customs says. So here's what they say. Although the grinder cup is removable, it is entirely made of plastic and appears to be disposable. So the most important part here for us is it appears to be disposable. What does it mean? Not capable of repetitive use. or not likely to be used repetitively, right? So if you read those rulings, that's what I really like about reading. This really should be highlighted and bolded, right? It should be made clear. Oh, look, GRI 5 argument. Because further down, here is what they say. The applicable subheading for the bottle of sea salt will be 2501, which provides for salt, including table salt, etc., etc., right? No separate classification provision for the bottle itself, because the bottle appears to be disposable. So what does it mean? Clear application of GRI 5B, right?
Yes.
GRI 5B, where the customs has held. Let's see. Page up. Where the customs has held that packing material, packing container, entered with a good, shall be classified with a good if they are kind of normally sold with such good. And it's not suitable for repetitive use. So it's normally sold. Yes, you walk into the store, it's normal for you to find the salt with a grinder, so you grind it up, right? And then most likely, once you finish, you'll throw it away. Because if people wouldn't be throwing it away, they wouldn't be buying other grinders with another salt. They would be just buying salt packets, right? And the channels of commerce clearly indicate that shelves are just stacked with those grinders, the salt with the grinders. And because they just continue selling it, that means there is a consumer demand. Whether artificial or not, this is a different question. But the consumer demand is indicative of the normal use. Use it, throw it away. But I like that. Yeah, I wasn't sure until I looked it up. So
that's a good one.
Yeah. Utilitarian use, though, sometimes can take over. So if you have a nice fancy one, right? Huge fancy one, not just the one at disposal, because the buzzwords here, you use it, you throw it away, right? If you don't throw it away, you continue to hold on to it, then the whole argument would have led to a different conclusion. So GRI 6. The last of GRIs. So we covered 5 GRIs, and we got to the GRI number 6. And if you paid attention to the use of GRIs 1 through 3, and you feel more or less comfortable with the use of GRIs 1 through 3, then you should have no problem applying GRI 6, because all what GRI 6 is about is saying, look, we have GRI 1, we have GRI 2, we have GRI 3. Let's use those GRIs in the context of analysis, but not the analysis that is pertinent to the GRI 1, GRI 2, GRI 3, because this analysis, the GRI 1 through 3 analysis, GRI 1 through 3 analysis is mostly what are we talking about? The heading level. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. All right. So the heading is this. Those first four digits of the harmonized tariff schedule number. But we all know that harmonized tariff schedule is comprised of more than just four digits. We know that, right? Here, we have a heading. Then we have subheadings, which is 6th, 7th, and 8th. So 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th, right? And we have statistical suffix. So we can get away with heading analysis, right? By using GRI 1 through 3.